Africa considered one of the highest growth regions in the world, and it's also, it has close proximity to us here from Dubai. It's been growing quite well. We can expect the growth to continue. If you look at the numbers, the non-oil trade between Dubai and Africa has one of the highest growth rates. It's grown from $10 billion in 2008 to $30 billion in 2014. We expect this growth to continue going forward. In Africa, when you look at the north, we have Egypt, our largest trading partner, with close to 16 billion dirhams worth of trade. And we see quite a good growth going forwards because of the positive momentum and developments happening in Egypt. In the south, we have South Africa, around close to 10 billion dirhams. And again, we see the momentum will continue because of the region in South Africa. Also, we have Sudan with close to 9 billion dirhams worth of non-oil trade. We realize that the whole world wants to do business in Africa, but understanding Africa is one of the biggest challenges. And this is why we launched last year an app, a smart application focusing in Africa and the opportunities and more of the basic understanding that we understand that main businessman who wants to do business in Africa has to know these basics. The African Global Business Forum is a main platform for us to connect Africa with the world and connect the world with Africa. And of course, Dubai sits in the middle of that. We try to connect the opportunities and talk about the challenges and connect businesses and investors from both sides.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your attention. I thought that last session was absolutely fantastic, really fascinating. I particularly liked the way that the President of Mauritius invoked the Nike slogan, just do it. And that actually might be a message also for the next session, which is about the new drivers, Africa's future factories, a change perhaps in the evolution of developing countries towards advanced industrial status. Anyway, the moderator for this session will be Mark Edo, who, as you know, is a real Africa expert. And yet again, I will advertise the TV program that he will be starting early next year, a breakfast TV show which will be broadcast throughout Africa and also in the USA. His guests here will be Jay Ireland, the president and CEO of GE Africa, Tarek Sultan, the CEO of Agility from Kuwait, and Mawuena Trebarh, the CEO of the Ghana Investment Promotion Center. Mark, please, and gentlemen, join the podium here. Thank you. And Ms. Mawuena, thank you.
Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning. There's a simple formula that most higher income nations use. You add one part cheap labor, one part cheap exports, and then you sprinkle in a little determination and luck, and voila, your country is on the path to prosperity. It's a formula that most African nations can't adopt because now digital technology is changing business models. The landscape is changing. Plus, Africa's manufacturing capability is not. According to the UN, despite all the growth that we hear and we've heard over the past 2 days in Africa, Africa commands a meager 1.5% of the share of the world's total manufacturing output. The question, though, is the concept of factory-based production models something that is becoming outdated with the rise of technology? Could technological advances bring new approaches, and new approaches that Africa could take advantage of? One thing is for certain. For Africa to take off, Africans will have to start making a lot more things. Now, we've got a wonderful panel to discuss what the role of business is based in Africa and what their role is in this brave new world. So without much ado, I'd like to introduce you to Jay Ireland, who is the president and CEO of GE Africa, amongst other things. He's many accolades. He's amongst the members of President Obama's Advisory Council on Doing Business in Africa. And he won the Africa Investor Magazine's International Business Leader Award, not just in 2012, but in 2013 as well. And Jay is located in Nairobi. Tarek Sultan is the CEO and Vice Chairman of Agility. Agility is one of the biggest logistics companies in the world, and Agility loves Africa. Already present on ground in 22 countries, it's committed to spending up to $4 billion building a distribution network that connects the whole continent. And last but certainly not least, Mawuena Trebarh, who's the Chief Executive Officer, Ghana Investment Promotion Center in Ghana, and she was handpicked by the president there to be at the center of Ghana's efforts to promote specific projects in key areas for investment by local and foreign investors. And you're the recipient of numerous international and national awards as well, including being a role model and a youth leader. You're all welcome. Give them a round of applause, please. Now, a general question for you. Few countries, I was talking about the path to progress, few countries have succeeded without getting a lot of people through factory gates. Now, in Africa, is that as important in this current climate? Perhaps, Jay, you can talk about that. Sure. You're all across. I talked about how Tarek was in 22 countries. GE is across Africa as well. From your perspective, how important is it to supercharge manufacturing and get Africa on this path to progress?
Well, I think, good morning. I think the most important thing that every African country wants to focus on is creating jobs. And it's not just African countries, it's everywhere globally. Everyone needs more jobs. And when you look at the manufacturing sector, it's obviously a huge job generator in a lot of countries. In Africa, one of the problems is as you said earlier, the share of the world's manufacturing is about 1.5%, and in Africa, manufacturing sector, sub-Saharan Africa, manufacturing sector is about 6% of all jobs. In Southeast Asia, it's 11% to 15%. So there's a huge potential, and when I look at it, there's a few different things that really drive that, and I think it's a key. One is security of supply of electricity. If you're going to put, we're on both sides of that argument. We obviously sell power generation equipment, but we also build factories. And when we look at putting a factory anywhere, we need to make sure that we have power, we have logistics capability, which Tarek's company provides. We have the capability to get skilled labor and skills, engineering skills, are especially technical, and all three of those are areas where a lot of countries in sub-Saharan Africa really need to invest in and continue to invest in. And it's not necessarily an aspect of quality as much as it's a quantity. So we need availability of power. We need, again, security of logistics to be able to import or to get stuff we buy into the plants and what we're selling out to our customers when they need it. And then we need a continued focus on getting blue collar as well as engineering and technical talent through the universities and hired into companies.
Now you've touched on a number of points there: skills acquisition, education. You've talked about what's happening on the ground. Tarek, you are on the ground, 22 countries and rising. You know exactly what's going on because you're not just walking the walk, you're not just talking the talk, you're walking the walk as well. You go into a country, you set up massive infrastructures there. Many of the people that you employ are local, indigenous, I think over 90% in some cases, in some countries. Is manufacturing expanding across Africa? When you're on ground, what do you see? Are the skills there or are they improving? And what are some of the challenges you're facing when you go into countries?
That's great. Well, first of all, I'd like to step back and talk about the opportunity for a second.
Can you speak up a little?
Yes, I'd like to basically talk about the opportunity a little bit and describe it. You have 7 of the 10 fastest growing economies in the world. You have growing democratic governance, which is we've seen a big difference in the quality of the governance over the last 10 years and how it impacts our business. You have a population of 1 billion growing to 2 by 2050. You have rapid urbanization of the continent and massive flows of infrastructure investment. So fundamentals are really, from the outside looking in, are really there. At the same time, we know that China, over the next 10 years, will be up to 90 million jobs exiting China, looking for a place where the workforce can provide some competitive advantages. And one of the few markets that can actually provide that is Africa. You have a growing workforce, estimated to be 1.25 billion by the year 2050, and it's an ideal situation for one looking to develop industry. But having said that, what are the challenges? Clearly, we talk about first and foremost access to power. We need to have stable, cost-effective power. Most industries are being driven by sort of ad hoc diesel-fired sort of generators. That's not a way to build an industrial base. So clearly, we have to address the power situation. Two, we need to see continued investment in infrastructure across the board. And I think we'll talk a little bit about that. But to me, the most important infrastructure that needs to be invested in is the infrastructure and technology that's needed to make Africa an easier place to do business. 9 out of every 10 new jobs in the emerging markets are coming from the SME segment. And unless we are able to focus on making Africa an easier place to do business, we will rob ourselves of the medicine that we need to actually grow our economy. And that's really, I think, what we need to focus on, the technology to make Africa an easier place to do business in.
And you, now you mentioned small and medium-sized enterprises. And Mawuena is not your average investment seeker. You really have a very, when you approached this job, I think you took this job on 2 years ago, was it? About 2 years ago. I remember when the president gave you the position. You've got a very clear philosophy on how you engage international and national investors, because traditionally in Africa, investment has gone towards raw materials. The problem with that is that raw materials don't translate to instant jobs, and you have a population that's I think the population doubles in 35 years in Africa. That's the estimation. Almost 1 billion people.
Yes.
Many of them young. And many of them entrepreneurial and seeking a better future. This is central to your approach to investors. Now, you were telling me earlier about how you articulate that to them. I'm an investor, for example. What would you be saying to me?
Well, Mark, salutations, obviously, to our hosts for having us at this forum. It's fantastic to be here. What we have sought to do is, first of all, address the existing perceptions about doing business in Africa, doing business in Ghana. It is important that the business community begin to appreciate how much the continent and various countries' governance systems have evolved. Not unlike many other African countries, Ghana is very interested in strategic partnerships with a business community that understands that we would really like to ensure that they are profitable, but at the same time, those investments have to translate into development. What is development? It's jobs, it's skills transfer, it's the opportunity to create more ancillary jobs as a result of that investment, with clear indicators that allow you to track your progress. And I think articulating that clearly and concisely, presenting very specific projects that have a relevance for our development agenda, ties in very well with many of the individual companies and institutions that we are looking to. So it's a very strategic decision that we have priority sectors for development, There are businesses all over the world, including UAE, that are best in class. We can identify those companies, those institutions, and engage, develop partnerships that allow us to be very targeted. And when it comes to the issue of manufacturing, because has been alluded to in several of the other panel discussions, agriculture and agroprocessing is probably going to be one of the major fundamentals for continued growth on the continent. It becomes especially important that we target manufacturing, and therefore all of the ancillary requirements, power, infrastructure are important, but just as equally important is the ability to build the capacity of the education base, so the vocational training institutes that will support all of those medium to long-term investments in the manufacturing sector. Those are the things that we've been articulating, and I think that certainly in the Ghanaian context, we're beginning to see some of the fruit of all of those efforts to attract the right kinds of strategic investors.
What sort of fruit have you borne? How have you changed things? You've had about 2 years or so.
Over the last 18 months, we've seen a 300% increase just in manufacturing.
A 300% increase
in manufacturing.
Wow.
Because we've been very specific. If I may use a particular example, we're currently in the process, interestingly, of collaborating with the government of Mauritius. Our head of state has been there specifically pursuing some of those strategic investments in the textile industry. They have a very long-standing, excellent track record in that industry. We certainly would like to grow some of the job opportunities, as Tarek had mentioned, that will be moving from Asia to Africa and attract some of those to Ghana. We've been very successful positioning ourselves as a hub of access to the rest of West Africa, so we're a natural fit for developing the manufacturing industry. And that's where you're seeing the proliferation of free zones and enclaves to support some of that agenda. So a lot of companies can be guaranteed a place to plug in and play, really. And that's really the strategic view that we're taking. What is it that we want to achieve from a development agenda? However, what are the legislative and regulatory requirements that will support the investor to ensure that they return profitability to their shareholders?
Now, let me bring that subject back to Jay and Tarek, either of you. Mawuena mentioned free trade zones. Yesterday, we had a very interesting conversation about the tripartite free trade area, 26 countries who are coming together to harmonize their business environment and make ease of business. Business easier. Are you optimistic that this is, to some degree, a game changer in the way you do business? Because you're both Pan-African, and also, what effect would this have on manufacturing? What effect would it have on you, on GE, for example?
Well, from our perspective, it's twofold. One is you need to have regional capability, meaning the ability to move goods and people, et cetera. And I think we're starting to see that really take hold with the East African community, ECOWAS, SADC, et cetera. But there's still way too little inter-Africa trade. All right, so part of that is to have the free trade zones, et cetera, that you do things internally and then ship out to wherever they need to be, rather than export everything in. So, because sometimes it's easier to export things in because you don't have the free trade zones, cheaper from that standpoint. So that helps quite a bit. So I think it's a key factor. I think between manufacturing facilities and logistics facilities, Tara can speak about that. But the ability to have the ability to come through the customs clearances, all of the stuff that you normally do around that becomes very problematic, and depending on the countries and how well they're digitized in their customs capability, et cetera. And again, I go back to the security of the logistical value chain, if you will, to get goods in and goods out.
Yes, clearly there are examples now of good regional sort of cooperation yielding benefits to the free movement of goods and trade. And, but I think it's very important to focus on the micro level. And I'll give you a study from the African Development Bank identified that the average customs transaction involves 20 to 30 stakeholders. involves over 40 documents, 200 data points, and about 60 to 70% rekeying of information. And that's just in a specific country. So that you can imagine the situation as you go across borders becomes more and more complex. You just take that and you exponentially multiply how difficult it is to actually get some of these transactions done. So what's the net result of that? The net result is that the trade, inter-African trade, is about 16% of total, whereas the equivalent number in the EU is about 60. So again, all of these things somehow come back to the same thing, I believe, and that is, if we really want to unlock the potential of growth, the best thing to focus on is the thing that's come for free. And we can make it easier to do business by investing in the underlying technology that facilitates trades. These are like online custom systems and related processes that will really, that require, in my opinion, very small investments relative to the systemic effect that they have for job creation and growth.
We have to talk about electricity when we're talking about manufacturing. These are often quoted statistics, but electricity, of course, oils the wheel of industrialization everywhere. Yet 48 countries in sub-Saharan Africa generate only 68,000 megawatts of electricity, and that's just like one country in Europe, like Spain, for example, in the whole of Africa. I mean, that's a profoundly low amount. I mean, I'm from Nigeria, and of course, GE have played a big part in trying to turn that around. Power outages result in almost 12.5% of lost production time compared to 7% in South Asia, which is the next worst case. Mm-hmm. What are we going to do about that, and how is that going to change manufacturing? Perhaps I definitely should start with you.
Well, I think the easiest thing is to buy more GE turbines. So, but quite frankly, I think the biggest aspect of power is, again, I go back to what I said before, access and availability. And there are two key things that every head of state looks at: access to get as many people hooked up to the grid and with electricity, and then obviously availability. But availability is what's going to really drive economic growth, because that means that the companies that are manufacturing or service oriented have a secure supply of power. So if you look at Nigeria, there are more power is generated from diesel generators than from the grid. And the problem with that isn't that they have access to the availability of electricity. The problem is it's costly. And if you look at Sub-Sahara in general, it's three times, the cost of electricity is 3x the cost of electricity in Southeast Asia. So everyone talks about potentially a labor advantage in wages, et cetera. But that gets eaten up between the cost of electricity, and then there's a cost of no electricity. So not having the electricity, people don't invest because they don't see the opportunity. They have to, again, put their own generators in. They have to do their own fuel source. It's too hard. So they go elsewhere. And they'll pay instead the logistics and export or import fees because at least they can you can then ensure that you get your products made, et cetera. So I think it's a linchpin. And obviously, I have a vested interest in electricity generation, but if we look at, the second part of what you talked about earlier, the digital aspect, every cell phone, every computer, all the internet, they all need power. So there's no way that you need electricity, and I think that's the biggest issue that you have. And so you talk about 68 gigawatts between 40 some odd countries, that is really a real issue that we've got to continue to address, and it's all about really getting availability for economic development.
When it must be something that comes up all the time, whenever you evangelize for Ghana, electricity obviously is a central challenge, opportunity.
Yes.
What is it for you?
I'm an investment promotion officer. Every challenge is always an opportunity. But I think what is truthful is that we recognize where the gaps are. If you look at a country like Ghana, the reality is that we are in the midst of a significant power crisis. It's had significant impact on the business community and their ability to sustain commercial activities. Now, having recognized that, again, all of the excitement around growth on this continent has also been coupled with the inadequacies, quite truthfully, in some of the planning in order to meet all of this demand in growth. And therefore, many countries like ourselves have had to look again at what will be required to quickly close that gap. And so again, taking a very clear strategic view that perhaps in Ghana's case, we cannot continue to rely on hydropower solutions alone. We will have to look at a number of other alternatives and create the right balance between renewable energy solutions, hydropower solutions, atomic energy solutions. That discourse has then been integrated into targets that are very specific for those of us who are inviting the business community and working through a process where we can support them. Because we also recognize some of the anxieties that have been articulated by the international audiences about bureaucracy and what's required. So there are service provisions within the GIPC that allow us to walk with you, walk through the details, and make sure that the power purchase agreements make sense from a commercial side, but also meet our obligations. It's not always easy, I'm sure Jay will attest to that. But the reality is that we have to be diligent in order that we don't meet the same challenges because we're continuing to grow in spite of some of the macroeconomic challenges we face. And therefore, taking the strategic view that beyond the 5,000 megawatt target, we actually need additional contingencies. Where are those going to come from? It is precisely because of that we would approach a GE or various other best-in-class companies that have expertise, let's say, in renewable energy solutions, so that the business community has a number of options to serve the purpose. So obviously, there's also the opportunity with some big industries. For instance, the mining industry that's been a long part of Ghana's history. Like everybody else, they want reliable power and they will pay the premium for it. They're also looking at opportunities to serve that community with specific power requirements so that the residential and other small to mid-sized companies that also require power can also be served efficiently. And I think that when you put all of that in context, then you're working towards a recipe that's more sustainable than perhaps had been previously the case. So obviously I'm quite optimistic that in irrespective of those challenges, because there's now a very clear strategic view of what's required. So I only present specific projects with specific opportunities. I'll give you the initial capital outlay, I'll give you the location, I'll give you the feasibility studies, I'll give you the legislative requirements, everything that you need to take an informed decision so that we can quickly close those gaps.
Now, I have to remind you that you are the fourth panelist on this stage through the AGBF app as well as Twitter. If you send your questions through that, it will come to a gentleman over there who will bring it to me on the stage on this iPad. So please send your questions through and we'll see if we can get through to them. Before I read any of these questions, I want to move on to a little bit into the future. Let's go back to the future and talk about digital technology. We've seen the rise of mobile phones. In fact, Jay, you believe perhaps that that in terms of the use of mobile phones, Africa is further ahead than anywhere else in the world. Mm-hmm. You believe that this is a big game changer. I just want to see from your own distinct and very interrelated but distinct positions what digital technology can do for us in terms of revolutionizing the landscape and creating jobs. And I want to go back to Mawuena on that, because this also must be a big part of your vision for bringing investment into the Ghanaian economy and raising the GDP. Digital technology, what does it mean?
Absolutely. I mean, I think it's one of those big game changer indicators for Ghana. I think we're a bit of an anomaly, to be honest. We've had probably within the sub-region the single largest investments in telecoms infrastructure, far and away ahead of most of our peers in the sub-region. We've launched 4G technology, and its application is having fundamental impact on the way people are doing business. It's very exciting to see telecoms companies, the electricity company of Ghana, various other electricity-related institutions looking to telecommunications to support, for instance, the payment provisions and creating more efficiencies in payment services for consumers. I think what is just as interesting is the way the financial services sector is also leveraging technology. And there's no question in my mind that, again, if you look at manufacturing, that's going to be a very exciting platform to build more expertise, new skill sets, and quite frankly, a lot of innovation. So we've got quite a proliferation of software development providers, et cetera.
Do you think, I mean, you work for a parastatal, I guess I could call it,
yes,
for the government. Do you think the government's job is to lead this change or adapt to it or just get out of the way?
I think government must, in many ways, strike the right balance between demonstrating the importance of applying technology. So what you're seeing is a lot of state institutions now looking to new technology service provisions, GIPC included, to create more efficiencies in the way, the speed with which they can respond to the business community. So we, for instance, are institutionalizing our one-stop shop to make sure that the business community has just one point of contact for interacting with all government institutions, licensing provisions, et cetera, the Registrar General's office. So we're shortening the lead time to register companies because of the technology application. We're seeing this cut across with e-governance technology as well. So all of those provisions are clearly as a result of the quality of the technology that we have available. And we're seeing that, I think, driving a lot of the interest from the private sector in innovation and entrepreneurship to address some of the social and development challenges that we have. I think it's just going to continue to naturally happen. Government at the same time will want to put the relevant regulatory and legal indicators in place to create clarity. There's always going to be questions about information access, et cetera, security of information as we get more and more sophisticated. Our Social Security National Insurance Trust Fund, for instance, these are all really going to become the bedrock of access to other financing options for investing, and you will definitely need technology to support that.
Gentlemen, digital technology, how much of a game changer?
I think it's going to be huge. I live in, as you said, I live in Kenya. I think Kenya is the most advanced mobile technology country in the world. And people, when I say that, they kind of look at me surprisingly. But the reason is because the mobile technology has provided access to a whole, to everybody almost.
Right.
I mean, you can go anywhere in Kenya, the most rural village, and somebody will have a cell phone in there, and it's their bank account. You know, they're transferring money. They're doing. You've mentioned M-Pesa, but there's more than just M-Pesa, and it's. I think you know that is the dynamic that, and what it does is it changes the mindset of the people on how they can think about entrepreneurial efforts. So there's ways that are occurring. I mean, right now, access to electricity is an example. There's a couple of companies that are involved that bring solar. The key thing for all of this is to get paid. And so what the M-Pesa has the availability of you basically getting paid remotely. So you can put a solar panel on a house in a village, and it'll work only when it gets paid through the mobile through M-Pesa. And those are the kind of things that is a technology that's been developed that talks about access. In the U.S., it's all about a $600 smartphone.
Yeah,
And that's not going to work everywhere.
Old Nokias.
Yeah, exactly. And that's the dynamic. So
one of the things I was thinking of was the commodities as well.
Well, commodities exchange in Ethiopia
has
dramatically changed the whole aspect of agriculture, especially coffee and some of the other commodities in Ethiopia. Really making sure the farmers get the fair prices for what they want, and more importantly, have a timing of understanding. So all of that can change the dynamic in Africa. When I look at healthcare access and healthcare capability, the ability of having trained doctors and nurses, typically in urban settings, but being able to get their capability out into a broader range, you can use mobile technology around that. So there's a whole slew of potential. I was mentioning to Mark earlier today, a couple days ago, I read that iPay, which is the Apple payment system, is going to be able to be able to transfer cash between two people shortly. Well, you know, they've been doing that for 10 years in Africa. So it's, and I think that those are the kind of things that I don't think people understand enough about the digital revolution, if you will, that is occurring in Africa, especially around the entrepreneurial capability. So I think that's a narrative that hopefully people will continue to focus on.
Now we're talking about agriculture. When you talk about agriculture, you're also talking about storing and distribution. So I'm going to take our first question from the iPad, and this one's for you, Tarek. It says, from V. Luhan, asks, with the growing number of multinational retail businesses like Carrefour and Nakamut expanding into and around Africa, what is the potential of retail warehousing as a major logistics platform for such businesses to store and move their goods? That's your stock in trade, is it not?
It is, and clearly there's a tremendous opportunity in Africa. I think the most important, in my opinion, is helping farmers in the agriculture industry get their products in a form that can be used by retailers. Retail is growing, but their ability to actually access local agriculture is often limited by the way that the supply chain works. So part of the investments that we are making in Africa are around our distribution center projects are to target specifically this sector, to see what we can do about packaging and sort of sorting products in a way that will impact the agricultural community in a very sort of fundamental way. We have examples of doing this in India for Metro and other retailers, and I think that it can have a tremendous impact in improving the welfare of farmers going forward. But I also wanted to come back to the digital technology question, because I think in our industry, if you look around the world, what do you see? You see overcapacity of ships, you see overcapacity of ports, you see airplanes flying around the world, 50% of them empty of cargo space. So for me, the digital revolution, at least in an African context, provides the opportunity to actually not make the mistakes that have been made in other economies. And you have the ability to leapfrog directly into a sharing economy. And again, having access to supply chain and capabilities that will enable that will only make these investments in infrastructure more realistic and more profitable going forward.
Okay, another question. This time it's for Mawuena. It says, from Aurelian, do you have a platform to share best practices with your neighbors in Africa in terms of smart government and e-government? And in brackets it says where the UAE expertise is quite huge, actually.
Actually, we do. I wouldn't say there's a technological platform. But there's a deliberate decision that's been taken in a forum among CEOs of various investment promotion agencies across the continent to engage regularly, support built capacity building. And obviously for us, again, we look to our collaborations, for instance, with the Dubai Chamber, with a number of other institutions globally that have developed certain quality of expertise and service provision in supporting business growth. And those are some of the things that we're applying in our context. So we have a deliberate inflow, if you will, of some of our counterparts from other African countries. I think we recently hosted Burkina Faso, the Investment Promotion Agency CEO and her team. I have been out to Mauritius, as I said. I've been to the Dubai Chamber as well. We're actively pursuing, as I said, those opportunities that will allow us to improve our efficiencies and utilizing and leveraging the opportunities that come with the technology applications, as I said. Ghana's probably, again, the only country within the sub-region with a complete national fiber backbone. And that, of course, means that we can plug into across the country a number of different service provisions. So yes, there is some of that provision. Obviously, we would look forward and welcome the opportunity to identify more collaborations.
Gentlemen, I'm going to put you on the spot now, and I'm going to ask you to be country-specific. Of course, you've got to say nice things about Ghana, because Mawuena's right here. But in terms of countries, the both of you have this in common. You operate across the region. In terms of ease of doing business and what you see that you like in terms of business, in terms of development, what are some of the standouts in terms of countries? Tarek, I'm going to go to you first.
Well, I mean, clearly South
Africa. You have to be sensitive here, but.
Yes, sir. I think clearly the World Economic Forum publishes statistics on these sorts of things, on the ease of doing business. So for anybody that's interested, there are clear benchmarking results of countries and how they're doing it. I think the important thing is to look at the trend. And in Africa, the trend is going upwards. And I think we need to focus not necessarily on the absolute term, but on the relative. And I think there is progress being made. But the pace at which the progress is being made needs to accelerate. And in particular, the interesting countries that I think have done a good job. Clearly, Ghana, we've been one of the first places we've invested in our sort of logistics infrastructure project is in Ghana. We're very much sold by the governance and the way that things are improving, but we also obviously South Africa is a very interesting market for I think everybody. But we need to see more of that in Eastern Africa as well.
I would say I look at it from a standpoint of regional capability. So as I said earlier, we had ECOWAS. EAC and SADC, so all of those help. So when you look at doing business in a region, we're not going to be able to do 54 GEs in Africa. We have to pick and choose where we put different businesses, different factories, etc. to serve. So we look at that. So there's a regional overlay, number one. And I would say at this point in time, probably the East Africa community is the furthest along from this.
Why?
From the standpoint of, the policies as far as allowing people movement, goods movements, et cetera, and then also to a degree the execution. I think ECOWAS is getting there. It's still too long to get from Nigeria, let's say, to the Ivory Coast, shipping goods in trucks or trains or whatever. So I think we're starting to see that improve. As far as doing business in a country, for a company like ours, we're a large company, and we're able to do probably things a little differently. And what I worry about is what Tarek said earlier, is about the SMEs, because the SMEs are really the function of economic growth. So if you look at what we would do as a multinational, we want to invest in a supply chain. We want to build out the broader economy. So in the developed world, for every GE job, there's probably 8 jobs that are in a supply chain, a logistics chain. In Africa, we're not even at 1-to-1. So we have to build that out and work with it. Now, I think the other big piece of, and this gets to the manufacturing and selling and stuff, is of doing business is the localization policies. And I think those are the ones that businesses have to pay attention to, multinationals coming in. Versus, let's say, the local businesses, but those are also another overlay that you have to deal with. But so I think overall, we're getting better. We're starting to see a lot of improvement, and I think I would say that you can tell where we feel comfortable about where it is easier to do business by where we're putting our investments. You put the money where money's and CapEx and stuff is where you want to be, closer to the markets and places you can do business.
G likes Ghana. That is one of the places they're putting business. But Jay makes a point about small and medium-sized enterprises being the real fuel that will grow and supercharge Africa and Africans' economy. That's central to a lot of the things that you do. What is your What is your approach when it comes to SMEs? I mean, one of the problems that they have, the biggest problem we all know, is access to capital, access to finance. That's the same thing in my country, in yours, and all the countries that you gentlemen go to. How do you tackle that from your perspective, from an investment perspective?
Well, I mean, there are two things, Mark. I think the first thing is to appreciate the existing capacity of the SME community and identify smart ways to help them to build that capacity to meet all of this interest in investing from the international business community. So many times when we go out on investment missions, we would have already spent time region by region identifying some very exciting investment opportunities that have been developed by the SME business community. It's interesting that when we approach, for instance, European countries and talk to them. They also have a history and a culture of small to mid-sized companies. So obviously the definitions are quite different because of the size and scale and the differences in economics. However, they appreciate where our SME community is. Our role is to support the SME community to properly profile the potential opportunity to partner. Okay. The other thing is to work with some civil society, non-governmental organizations and institutions that can help them to develop their business plans, their governance systems and structures within their organizations in a way that makes it interesting and exciting to engage with the international business community. So our approach has been very hands-on, if you will. We have a regional sensitization tool around the entirety of the country. So we're uncovering a lot of incredible, exciting entrepreneurial stories. Ghanaians who are really doing world-class work, they are applying new technologies, and we're showcasing that to the international business community. I think on the financing side, we've again been very deliberate. For the next quarter, 2016, we have an SME financing fair. Now, for the Ghanaian SME community, it's a huge opportunity to engage with financiers, with potential joint venture partners, but we've been very particular about the quality of the SME that can come into that forum. And these are deliberate decisions, as I said, because we already recognize where most of, if you will, our meat and potatoes come from economically. And then I think that's the context in which we want to showcase Ghanaian corporate excellence in that community. And there are also a lot of institutions, private people, who are showcasing through recognition, award ceremonies, et cetera, people who are doing a lot of innovative things. And I think that's supporting the agenda to ensure that we're able to demonstrate the SME business community in Ghana, certainly on the continent, has the capacity to meet with the international business community. But we want to be sure that it's the right match, it's the right fit. And that's something that we actively will continue to facilitate.
You know, I think one of to hop on that for a minute is the collaborative environment, I think, is key today. So, if you know, in Nairobi, there's a couple of things. iHub, we have that in Lagos, and where you can pull together these digitally oriented companies where they work together and really collaborate, and then you really get some great products and capabilities. And I think that, to me, is if governments can really, you know, support that kind of effort, because there tend to be very entrepreneurial small businesses, single entrepreneurs with an idea, but they need a collaborative effort, and then tied into that would bring the financing, et cetera. Right. And we're doing a couple of pieces. We're doing one in Lagos, Nairobi, and Johannesburg, and that's the GE Garages, where we're bringing advanced manufacturing techniques, 3D printing, CNC machines, et cetera, to show what can be done with the technology that's readily available today, and then hopefully drive some new manufacturing ideas that can be done on product development in Africa, in those three countries. So we're going to continue to expand that, but they're all in a collaborative area where we'll be able to pull great ideas from a lot more people.
Tarek, I said in your intro that Agility loves Africa. And I said you were spending up to $4 billion, 22 countries. When you're building on ground there, there must be a knock-on effect to SMEs in that region. Do you have a specific strategy that addresses promoting a stronger SME environment in the countries that you commit to?
We do. We work with governments around the world, actually, in developing their supply chain infrastructure the electronic supply chain infrastructure. So one example, we have a few reference cases with the ASEAN countries where we've worked on developing technology that helps facilitate trade and customs and related processes. And my thought there is that for every investment that's made, I imagine for every dollar that's made in that sort of technology, the corresponding multiplier is, I would say, 1,000. Because you're making, you know, once you simplify a process, you're simplifying that process forever, and every single sort of stakeholder in the economy is benefiting from it. So I think if I were to look out and say, what needs to happen first? I think that needs to happen first. We need to focus on reducing the non-trade barriers, focus on making Africa an easier place to do business, and I am pretty sure that that will take care of the financing problem. If you make it easier to do business, it'll be easier to attract capital. The easiest way to attract capital is to say, we're open for business.
I don't want to be a sort of a Cassandra here, but there seems to be we all know that that's important. We all agree that that's important. But we've got a government official, I don't know if you like to call yourself that.
Not
but
really.
Affiliate, perhaps. Okay. And we have some entrepreneurs with a firm commitment. But to me, whenever I go across Africa like you do, I see the spirit is willing, but the body is weak when it comes to getting government to talk to private sector. I'm not just talking about international major conglomerates. I'm talking about small and medium-sized enterprises. That conversation, we've been having a conversation about that conversation
yes.
for years now,
right.
But it's not moving along fast enough. Am I just being too pessimistic on this?
I think the focus should be, clearly the engagement with the SME community is important, but the focus needs to be on intergovernment cooperation. If you were to look at the number of stakeholders within a government that are involved in trade and related processes, it's basically every organ of the government is involved in those processes. So unless you can create a framework for those processes, you need a minister of the supply chain. We don't have a minister of the supply chain because the responsibilities of the minister of the supply chain have been distributed to every other ministry and government agency. So it's almost impossible to get something done that impacts the supply chain because you have involved in negotiation with 50 government agencies. If you look at Dubai, for example, key takeaways is how they've been able to put those stakeholders in one room and basically be the same stakeholder. And that's where I think going forward, we need organizationally to look at some of those success stories and say, how do we organizationally impact the way we can improve supply chain?
Jay.
Well, I think that business, and this varies by country, but the business community needs a voice into the government. And depending on the country, there are different organizations that do that. And there needs to be a dialogue, if you will, on both sides. Because it's not all, you know, we as businessmen sit there and say, oh, here's all the problems that we have with doing business in whatever country it is. But in reality, there's some issues that we have that governments take a look at private sector and say, hey, you guys aren't doing this. And so I think there's a balance there that has to happen. And it can be done through, and it's one thing, quite frankly, that I've been relatively frustrated with, is the ability to communicate to governments about best practices. You know, that Tarek mentioned.
I hear this a lot.
Yeah, that I you can then, you can, there's no reason for any government to learn about how to do things when it's been done somewhere pretty well before. And so how can we get some of those dialogues going and make sure that there's a limited distrust on both sides?
Right.
And I think we're both to blame, both sides, the public sector and the private, or the government and private sector. And I think we need to work through that. And the best way is to get the right organization with the right level of voice to really talk to the right ministers that are in charge and get some of these issues resolved. because we both want the same thing, which is continued economic growth in whatever country it might be.
That's your job.
That is my job.
I called you an evangelist to the outside, but your job is as a go-between.
That is our job.
And the government.
Actually, legislatively and constitutionally, that is part of our mandate. We are required to advocate communication between the private sector and government institutions.
But do you agree with what I'm saying, that a lot needs to be done to smooth that communication?
I think so. I think it's already happening. I mean, of course, I can only refer to the Ghanaian example. Yeah. We have a Ghana Club 100, the list of the top 100 companies in Ghana. Every quarter, there's a breakfast meeting. We talk about specific issues relevant to business at that moment. We invite the relevant sector minister, so he's listening to the private sector as they're talking about the issues that they're having. He's responding to them. They're talking about the relevant policy issues that perhaps need to be revised because of where we are currently. So it's a very real-time approach to addressing it. In addition, the president himself chairs a private sector advisory council. So all of the documentation, so it's not just a conversation and everybody leaves, that documentation is put before the president. So when he meets with the private sector advisory council, it's private sector players talking about some of the specific issues that they have. Again, he has the opportunity to say, look, in this area, we may need to revisit this issue or this challenge. So I think there's a deliberate move that needs to happen. I'm sure there are other institutions in other countries, but this is what we do in Ghana. And I think some of the results are, for instance, when you have a finance ministry about to announce budget, prior to that, the GIPC would have invited a forum of private sector people to meet with the finance minister.
That's new.
And erase that would be us,
yeah.
And raise some of the issues and concerns, which then reflect in what comes up in the next budget statement. So again, it's a very deliberate view to make sure that the private sector gets a word in. But at the same time, we also have to engage with the private sector and say, look, these are some of the challenges and some of the expectations. What can you also do to support? So to Jay's point, everybody has a role to play. It's very easy to point a lot of fingers, but inevitably, as we say in Africa, most of the fingers will be pointing back at you. And so we need to create that sort of balance.
I think in that, if you don't mind, one of the things that right now, I think if you're on the ground and doing business in a country, we have a lot of the countries have this kind of dialogue. So, and there's some, you know, there's some things from a multinational point of view as well. The AmChams, things like that. But the key thing right now is we need to get more investment in Africa. And the problem is a lot of the investment is coming from the developed or the so-called, what they all say, there's a lot of money to invest in Africa from the developed world. But the US and Europe, et cetera. The problem is they look at investing in Africa through a developed world's eye. Not a developing world.
What do you mean by that?
What I mean is the requirements that they put on things, the way they may, you know, give loans, etc., what they're asking the governments to do, and at the same point in time get a higher return for what they call a risky investment,
right.
Even though they want sovereign guarantees, letters of credit, etc., which isn't very risky.
Yeah. Exactly.
So there's a big disconnect, and I think that's that right now is holding up a lot of the investment. Ghana, classic case in point at this right. point in time. Now, we're going through a point of time, commodity prices, oil, et cetera, the currency issues in a lot of countries, but it's a point of time. You know, we had $100 barrel oil 2 years ago. So now it's 40, okay. It'll be probably I'm not prognosticating, but it'll be higher at some point in time too. So you can't make investment decisions for the long term based on a point in time. You have to take a look over
long-term
a period
view.
Of time. And I think that's what, there's a disconnect right now, at least in my opinion, in the financial community on how they're looking at investing and all.
Speaking of risk, Jay, it's not really a question, it's a statement that came from the audience. Scott says, our experience is there is an unreconciled expectation of higher risk and therefore higher reward But in fact, the cost of doing business in Africa offsets this for all the reasons discussed at this conference. Investors need to understand this. It does not mean you cannot get good returns, but expectations of super returns, even at peak cycles, need to be managed. Now,
I didn't need to say anything. That was pretty good summation.
Yeah. Very good summation. And we talked about engaging the private sector. Well, let's engage the private sector, because I understand there are some microphones now in the audience. Yes, I can see them over there. So if anybody wants to ask a question to the audience, to the panel, please go to the microphone and identify yourself, please, and ask your question. Who's going to be the first person? This gentleman standing up there, is it? No? Anyone? It's always difficult to get the first person. Then there's a flurry of people. Is anybody going to ask a question from the floor? No? Well, I'll ask a question from the iPad then. This one's for you, Mawuena. What is the ratio of women in the main economical decision makers and government parity in Ghana? I'll say that in English. How many women are there in government in Ghana? And, can it be expected one day to have a female president?
Oh my gosh.
Am I looking at the next female president?
God. You didn't just ask me that. this particular government under President Mahama has the largest number of women in ministerial positions. I think we're just about under 54% of the government. Certainly his ministerial appointments are quite a number of women. It's quite exciting to see how that application is just like any other organization. I'm coming from the private sector. This is my first public sector role, really. But you want to be able to include as many women as you can to create the diversity in different viewpoints. And I think, you know, obviously there's a strong push to ensure that it's not just about female representation, it's just about who's the best person for the job.
Contribution.
And then that's the contribution. I think that that's a particular focus. But obviously there are a number of benefits because you bring to the table a different style, if you will, in approaching governance and interactions with individuals who must provide a certain service provision. So I think President Mahama recognizes that. Many other African heads of states are applying that. We've heard that in some of the earlier forums. So fortunately, we're not unique.
Tarek, I know you've got a lot to say about this, because I know that Agility are quite aware of gender inclusion, as well as the youth bulge in Africa and the opportunities that presents to build your own business and also to build Africa.
That's correct. I did want to mention something about systemic risk. And
About risk, yes.
About risk. Which we do a lot of work with oil and gas companies, and without getting into details of names, when they look at risk, it's very interesting that they I can tell you of examples where they look at countries in North America and they assign, out of a scale of 1 to 5, a risk rating of a 4. And you kind of look at that and you say, well, what's your risk rating for corresponding investment in Africa? And I think the risk is sometimes less than that. And why is that the case? It's because it's the risk of systemic risk in some of the development economies is, in my opinion, much larger than is the case in Africa. The financial crisis came from the West, didn't originate in Africa. And so if you use that line of argument, you could actually make a case that the risk is somehow less in investing in Africa. And if that's the case, your returns, you could make an argument that the returns should be also less.
Let's end on that optimistic note. Please rise. Please, ladies and gentlemen, acknowledge your wonderful panel. Give them a round of applause, please. Mawuena Trebarh, Tarek Sultan, Jay Ireland. Thank you so much. Now we're going to take a 30-minute break to make more friends. And then we'll be back here at about 11:30. So please come back here. There's still lots more to do and lots more to hear. So thank you very much. Thank you.